Hello, I'm Mr. R. Nitya, a retired lecturer in Mythology, preaching Christianity and Sikhism. And here I'm reading exposition of Acts 25, verse 13. Paul before Agrippa and Bernice. Now when some days had passed, Agrippa the king and Bernice arrived at Caesarea and greeted Festus. And as they stayed there many days, Festus laid Paul's case before the king, saying, "There's a man left prisoner by Felix. And when I was at Jerusalem, the chief priests and the elders of the Jews laid out their case against him, asking for a sentence of condemnation against him. I answered them that it was not the custom of the Romans to give up anyone before the accused met the accusers face to face and had opportunity to make his defense concerning the charge laid against him." Remember what Nicodemus said, you know, if you want to condemn Jesus, let him also speak. And but they wanted to, you know, just summary persecution, summary killing. So the Romans were strict to the law, as expected and outlined by Nicodemus. So when they came together here, I made no delay, but on the next day took my seat on the tribunal and ordered the man to be brought. When the accusers stood up, they brought no charge in his case of such evils as I supposed. Rather, they had certain points of dispute with him about their own religion and about a certain Jesus who was dead, but whom Paul asserted to be alive. Being at a loss how to investigate these questions, I asked whether he wanted to go to Jerusalem and be tried there regarding them. But when Paul had appealed to be kept in custody for the decision of the emperor, I ordered him to be held until I could send him to Caesar. Then Agrippa said to Festus, "I would like to hear the man myself tomorrow." Said he, "You will hear him." So on the next day Agrippa and Bernice came with great pomp and show to impress upon Paul, and they entered the audience hall with the military tribunes and the prominent men of the city. Then at the command of Festus, Paul was brought in, and Festus said, "King Agrippa and all who are present with us, you see this man about whom the whole Jewish people petitioned me both in Jerusalem and here, shouting that he ought not to live any longer. But I found that he had done nothing deserving death, and as he himself appealed to the emperor, I decided to go ahead and send him, but I have nothing definite to write to my lord about him. You know, the lords, they have slaves. So these kings and other things were slaves to Caesar, emperor. Therefore, I have brought him before you all, and especially before you, King Agrippa, so that after we have examined him, I may have something to write. But it seems to me unreasonable in sending a prisoner not to indicate the charges against him, that of course I should I'm sending him, forwarding him. There should be something written about him, you know, what charges they have. So Acts 26, verse 1 onward. So Agrippa said to Paul, "You have permission to speak for yourself." Then Paul stretched out his hand and made his defense. "I consider myself fortunate that it is before you, King Agrippa, I am going to make my defense today against all the accusation of the Jews, especially because you are familiar with the customs and controversies of the Jews." So he just gave a general introduction and giving a pomp, little bit edge to King Agrippa, as the other sycophant had done. "Therefore, I beg you to listen to me patiently. My manner of life from my youth, spent from the beginning among my own nation and in Jerusalem, is known by all the Jews. They have known for a long time, if they are willing to testify, that according to the strictest party of our religion, that means Pharisee, I have lived as a Pharisee. And now I stand here on trial because of my hope in the promise made by Demiurge God Yahweh of nature to our fathers, to which our 12 tribes hope to attain." So he was one of the chosen people, this Paul, but he was not Jew outwardly, but inwardly. Outwardly he was Roman, which he proclaimed. See, his tribal identity saved him. "To which our 12 tribes hope to attain, as they earnestly worship might night and day. But they are unfaithful to Abraham, as Abraham was not a Jew outwardly, but a Semite. And also, they become unfaithful to Demiurge God of nature Yahweh, who has established the sons of Abraham in the promised land of honey and milk, or Garden of Eden." Remember that it was Yahweh who called Abram from his homeland, come out of the homeland, and sojourn at this place, and I will give you promised land, and your generation will multiply. So this promise, and Abraham had faith in him, that he came and established himself like a new Adam. Remember, Melchizedek also was of similar situation. He too was a sadhu. Sadhu also renounced everything. He was purely spiritual. So sadhus don't marry. But he, this Abram, was married. So that was the only difference. Abram was a secular person and he was purely spiritual. So that is why Abram gave him tithe after winning the battle against the kings. So this land, which was promised land given to this Abraham and his son Isaac, and not to the slave son Ishmael, he was put outside the promised land boundary. So far the sons of Isaac, they were faithful to Abraham and Isaac and to their God, Demiurge God Yahweh. This land was of honey and milk, Garden of Eden. But whenever they became unfaithful to Abraham, as the 12 sons of Jacob, 11 were unfaithful, only one was faithful, Joseph. The same land became barren when Joseph was sold as a slave. I have put other videos on this topic and you can see it. For detailed discussions, I can give lectures on this topic that will be given in spirit, not by the dead letters of the books. And for this hope, I am accused by Jews, O King. Why is it thought incredible by any of you that God raises the dead? God is, you know, omnipotent, so he can do whatever he likes and is omniscient. I myself was convinced that I ought to do many things in opposing the name of Jesus of Nazareth. You know, when he was a disciple of Gamaliel, then he was incited against Jesus and the very name of the God, which they are not allowed to write. And Jesus was proclaiming to be Son of the Most High. And I did so in Jerusalem. I not only locked up many of the saints in prison after receiving authority from the chief priests, but when they were put to death, as angel Stephen was put, Stephen was angel, he was not a saint. John the Baptist was an angel, not a saint. To death, I cast my vote against them. That means he was in favor of their killing Stephen. And I punished them often in all the synagogues and tried to make them blasphemy, and in raging fury against them, I persecuted them even to foreign cities. So all here gives you all the information, you know. So he narrates how he was faithful, you know, to their old faith as the disciple of the Gamaliel. Disciples do what their masters tell them to do, or their teacher tell them to do. They don't ask him question. Disciples, they are blind, spiritually blind people, once born natural men. In Jesus, we have no disciples, but twice born laborers. So we are not spiritually blind. We are laboring sons of our Most High Father. But the Jewish people have corrupted the New Testament as well and made us tell people that we are disciples. But none of these university professors ever thought of what the root of disciple is. The root of disciple is discipline. You discipline a natural man, not the twice born sensible person. So these repetition, you know, these people in the university, they are dead, burying the dead letters. That is what Jesus was talking about. Let the dead bury their dead. So they are there without understanding, they keep on repeating. I asked them, you know, that John the Baptist said, I am baptizing in water. The one coming after me will baptize you in Holy Spirit. Then in whose name John the Baptist baptized Jewish men in water? And why he did not baptize a woman or a Gentile? None of them can give answer, but the answer is there in the same parable where he was baptizing at Jordan River. He told the temple priest, you are brood of vipers, and I can turn stones into sons of Abraham. Now they don't know what are the stones and how they are turned into sons of Abraham. If you know why Simon was called Peter, a stone, then you will understand what stone mean. But spiritual language they can't understand because they are drunk with the old wine of the letters. So don't worry, if you are not drunk with the old wine of the letters, you will love to listen to my videos. Our Father God blesses you.